Hallelujah. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. For another day. Amen. For joining us as we jump into his word, magnifying him. We had been coined and talking about the gift for the past few Sundays now. Amen. And in the Bible study, something came into my heart to kind of talk on, touch on. So we'll take a few Sundays and kind of talk on this about knowing him. Amen. To know him. And how to go about knowing him. The ways of knowing him. The ways of recognizing him. The ways of familiarizing yourself with who he is, his character, his nature. Amen. So we're going to just talk about and understanding some things when it comes to knowing our Father. Amen. So we're going to coin this series to know him. To know him. We'll just take a few Sundays talking about it. Amen. Amen. To know. Know means to regard as true beyond doubt. Have developed a relationship with someone through meeting and spending time with them. Be familiar or friendly with, to have experience, to know him, to know him. Now, when you get to talking about knowing him, and when you understand about knowing him, there is a difference in knowing him and knowing about him. Because if you can go your whole life knowing about him, and can sing, and can quote scriptures, and can preach, and can prophesy, and can evangelize, knowing about him. But to know him is a whole nother level. To know him means you've had some experiences that have shaped and changed your life for the rest of your life. To know him means you've been with him on your one-on-one time. You spent some time with him. You spent some quality time with him as the, you know, back in the day. You said you had to spend some QT. You spent some QT with him. It's really when you get the opportunity to know him. So understand that we can know him and then we can know about him. We can praise and know about him. Do you know we can preach and know about him? And my desire, my hope for my own life, is that I go my whole walk with him and then not know him. I refuse to be a minister that just knows about him, but have not taken the time to sit with him myself and commune with him myself. Or as Adam did back in the garden, walk with him in the cool of the eve, right? What's it mean to walk with him? Just to commune with him, to walk with him, to take the time to get to know him. So that's what we'll be talking about the next few Sundays, is just taking the time to really get to know him and get to understand who he is. And in knowing him is going to bring about a change in us. Because it's impossible to walk with a holy God, a loving God, and you not change, right? Amen. He's going to expose some things in you, because the closer you get to him, the closer you get to glory, the closer you get to love. One thing about love is love brings about clarity. Right? And the more I walk with him, the more clear I'm going to see some things in my own life. And I'm going to recognize some areas in my own life that I know I'm going to have to bring about a change. And I'll bring about that change with the help of the Holy Ghost. Right? It's not in my own power. He exposes it. I recognize it. With the help of the Lord, the Holy Ghost, I mortify those things that he shows me that are exposed in my life. Y'all see how this works? Right? But all of that comes through knowing him. Everything you do here in the earth is going to come through, especially with your walk with him, it's going to come by way of knowing him. You'll never fully understand the love of God if you don't never take the time out to get to know him for yourself. So that's why I'm so keen on taking the time out and getting to know God for yourself. So when life come and see you, because the scripture has already declared that life is going to come and see everybody. I don't care who you are. I don't care how much money you have. I don't care where you are in life. Life is going to come see you. The scripture declared that in Matthew 7. It said It said the winds and the waves came to see the wise and the foolish man. It only depended on what their house was built on, what their belief system was on. So when the winds and the waves and the flood come and see you, will it come see you saying that you know him or you know about him? And I can say for myself, I knew about him for some years. But here recently, the last few years, I've actually taken the time to get to know him for myself. And it has changed my life for the best. When you get the time to know him for yourself, when life comes and see me, I know who my daddy is now. I know who my father is. Y'all see how this works? Mm-hmm. Amen. So we're going to be talking about knowing him. All right. So let's start off in Jeremiah, because what I want to show you first is when you don't take the time to get to know him, where are we sitting? What happens? Right? So let's see what happens when we don't take the time to get to know him. So we're going to go to Jeremiah 9. I'm going to show you some scriptures. And then from Jeremiah, we're going to hit a couple of verses in John and 1 John. And then we'll finish it up in Philippians for the day. But like I said, we're going to take a few Sundays just talking about knowing him. I think it's real important for every believer to take the time to get to know him. Because see, what the enemy will do, he'll take your service, and through your service, you can think you know him through service. Y'all remember the story of Mary and Martha, right? One sat down at his feet, one was working, one was serving. And she said, hey, Jesus, you see me working? He said, but look, he said, Mary. She's chosen that good part. She's taking the time out to sit at my feet to what? To hear my words to what? To know me. To get to know me. And she let knowing me be way more important to her than serving. You see how that works? Let me tell you something. If you allow God, if you take the time to get to know him, and you allow him to, you give him your heart, your service is going to come. Everything else is going to come through that. I was talking to a young lady the other day. I said, look, I'd rather you take 10 years on knowing him and don't serve him for 10 years. Just take 10 years to know him. You'll get way further down the road just through knowing him. Y'all see how this works? All right. So now what happens when I don't? So we're in Jeremiah 9. Let's look at a few verses. Let's see what the scripture says. Let's see what the word of God says about this. Knowing him. Jeremiah 9. Let's start in the third verse. Third verse. Watch this. Jeremiah 9, third verse. And it reads, and they bend their tongues like their bow for lies, but they are not valiant, sincere. Another word for valiant is being sincere. All right? For the truth, watch this, upon the earth. For they proceed from evil to evil. Watch this now. And they know not me, saith the Lord. So he said they've established themselves in lies. They're not sincere going after the truth here on the earth. What is more truth here? What is the truth here on the earth? His word. What his word has to say about your situation. What his word has to say about issues here on the earth. What his word has to say about it. He said they're not desiring and sincerely going after that. He said, but for they proceed from evil to evil. And look at this last part. And they know not me, saith the Lord. So now watch this. Sixth verse. Go to the sixth verse with me. Thine habitation, the place where you abide. When you don't take the time to get to know him, your habitation, the place where you're abiding in, where you're sitting in, where you're established in your life. Let's see what the word has to say. Is in the midst of deceit. Through deceit, they refuse to know me, saith the Lord. So when you don't take the time to get to know him for yourself, if you go your whole life knowing about him through your pastor, knowing about him through your mother and father, knowing about him through grandma, knowing about him through other people's lives, and you never take the time to get to know him for yourself, get to experience him for yourself, become familiar with him for yourself, get to take time with him yourself. He said, you are established, your life will be established in deceit. And you'll open up the door for you to buy a bunch of lies, a bunch of wolf tickets. He said, because the adversary is forever selling wolf tickets. And if you don't know me personally, if you don't understand who I am, my character, how I operate, how I deal, you're going to buy every whoop ticket that comes your way. Why? Because you've established yourself in deceit. And he said, in that deceit, he said, you refuse to get to know who I am. Why? Because you're blinded by the lies. You're blinded. So when we come across people who don't know who our Father is, who don't understand some things, we got to know automatically what? That they bought a lie somewhere. There's a lie operating in their life. Right? And as you talk to them, let me tell you something. Just communing, talking with somebody, it'll expose where their belief is, what they're looking at, how they're seeing it. And he said, look, however they see it, however they view it, then you can expose the way they're looking at it. Right? By way of the Holy Ghost, he'll help you to see and expose whatever's going on there. Because we know now what? Their habitation is established on what? Deceit. And because of the lie, because of the blinding, they refuse to know him. Now watch this. Let's go to the 23rd verse. Same chapter. Watch this. Thus saith the Lord, let not the wise man glory in his wisdom, neither let the mighty man glory in his might. Let not the rich man glory in his riches. Now, y'all see that right there? So now look what he said. He said, let not the wise man glory in his wisdom. So don't glory in your intellect. Don't glory in how you can figure it out. Don't glory in how you analyze it, you calculate it. I see how this is going to work. Oh, he said, don't glory in that, your own intellect, your own logic. He said, neither glory in your might and how strong you are and how you could go about and do it. And you can, that doesn't have to be strong physically. You could be financially strong in some situations. And the situation happened, you'd be like, oh, we got that. We can handle that. We're good. Watch this. Then he said, look, let not the rich man glory in his riches. Oh, Lord. He said, don't glory in what your income is. If I bless you to make 50, if I bless you to make 100, he said, don't glory in your riches. Don't let your riches become a god to you. Don't let your might become a god to you. Don't let your intellect and your logic become a god to you. He said, don't glory in those things. Next verse. But let him that glory in this. Okay, so I see that's why I like the word of God, because he's going to tell you what the glory in. Hallelujah. He tells you not to do it, and then sometimes we just stop right there and say, well, see, that's David always trying to tell me what to do. But no, he's going to tell you what the glory in. What? Tell me more, Holy Ghost. That he or she understandeth and knoweth me. Hold on. He said, out of everything in life, I need you to glory in this. If you're going to boast on anything, I need you to boast on this. If you're going to mention anything and give glory to anything, he said, I want you to give glory to this. What is it again, Holy Ghost? That he or she understands and knoweth me, that you understand me, and that you know me. You understand who I am. You understand the character. You understand my nature. And you know who I am and how I'm going to bring about it, how I'm going to bring it about, how I'm going to bring you through. You know me when the situations arise. Did y'all see how this works? Watch this. That I am the Lord which exercises, watch this, loving kindness, judgment, righteousness in the earth. For in these things I delight, saith the Lord. Look what he's saying you need to glory in. Look what he's saying you need to boast in. Look what he's saying you need to keep your eyes on and keep focused toward. Look, knowing him, understanding him, and knowing him. And what do we need to know? His love and kindness. What? He loves me. He loves me because of his love. Watch this. Judgment. And that judgment is a judgment of judging the earth, of judging you. His counsel. His guidance. Watch this. Look at the next one. Righteousness. You need to understand what? That you're righteous. You're right state with the Father. Watch this. In the earth. Not in the sweet by and by. Look what he's saying. This happens here in the earth. This understanding, this knowing goes on here in the earth. Now this isn't Jeremiah. Right? So this happens here in the earth. Watch this. For this thing I delight, saith the Lord. He delights in a person who knows him. When life comes, when situations arises, A person isn't moved. Why? Because I know him. And one thing I do know, we're coming through this. One thing I do know, I'm going to win. One thing I do know, I'm going to be victorious. Why? Because I know him. I might not have the answer right off. I might not understand why this attack is hitting. But one thing I know, for I know who my daddy is. And one thing about my daddy, he has coined me victorious. I'm a winner. I'm a winner. Before the storm hit, before the trial hit, before it came, I'm winning. I go into it winning. How do you know you go into a situation winning? Because I know him. I know who he is. I lose everything, but guess what? I don't fall apart. Why? Because I know him. I lose my job, but I don't fall apart. I give glory. I start actually praising God because I know another door is going to open. Why? Because I know him. I have to file bankruptcy because of a situation that hit my life. But I don't fall apart behind bankruptcy. I give God the glory. Why? Because I know him. When you get to know him on that level, it brings an anchor to your life. It brings, it establishes you in some things. You will not be able to fall apart because what? I know who my daddy is. People come against you. Trials and situations arises, but it will not move you. Why? Because I know who he is. I've spent some time with him. I understand how he operates. I know he loves me. I know him. Y'all see how this works? So look what we're supposed to glow in. Y'all see that, right? And look, he said, what? In the earth. In the earth. Let's solidify that a little further. Go with me to John. John chapter 3. Let me show you something over there. John chapter 3, we're going to start in the 15th verse. John 3 and 15. Watch this now. We're talking about knowing him. We want to solidify this thing about knowing him. This is a good place to check your own life. He said, you know what, God? I think I need to know you more. I need to get to know you more. I need to make that a life goal to get to know you. Watch this. 15 verse. John 3, 15. Watch this. That whosoever, thank God for whosoever's. That's us. We whosoever's. That whosoever believeth, look at that word, in him should not perish. Whosoever believe in who? The Jesus Christ, the Son, our Lord and Savior, the one that he sent. He said, when you believe in him, guess what? You will not perish. I feel like I'm perishing. You're not perishing. You don't understand. You're not perishing. I don't care what you feel. I don't care what you think. The scripture says you will not perish. So guess what? You will not perish. Guess what? Look at the next piece. But have eternal life. Hallelujah. 16th verse. For God so loved the world. And when you read that, it's like he, it ain't like he just, God so loved the world. God so loved the world. It's like God so loved the world. That he what? That he gave his only begotten son. Watch this. That whosoever. They go that whosoever again. I think that's anybody, right? Anybody who chooses to believe and come on in, right? I don't care what color, creed, economic status. I don't care what you did in your lifetime. I don't care where you've been, how you did it, how you flipped it, how you tossed it, how you turned it. Hallelujah. That's whosoever who makes a decision to believe in him. Who is him? Would that be the same one? Jesus? Believe in him, should not perish. He said the same thing twice. I think he's trying to convey that over to us. Watch this. But have everlasting life. It's through him. Eternal life. Everlasting life. It's through Jesus Christ. And for years, I grew up thinking everlasting life was on the other side. Mm-hmm. You know, you're going to go through while you're here. You know, you're going to have some situations. You're going to have some hard times. But it all gets wiped away when you get over there with him. Hallelujah. You get with the Father. No more pain. No more sorrow. And that was true. That's true. That's true. Right? But it's something about everlasting life we need to understand here. So then what is everlasting life? Well, you always, whenever you have a question, it's best to let his word clarify it for you. So what is everlasting life? Because he said, look, if I believe, he said, I won't perish, I'm going to have everlasting life. Let's find out what everlasting life is. John 17. Because I need to know what everlasting life is. Because if I don't want to perish, I need to understand what this everlasting life is. Because I'm believing. Watch this. John 17. We're going to start in the second verse. John 17. Second verse. Watch this now. As thou hast given him power over all flesh. Watch this. That he should give eternal life to as many as thou hast given him. Now, here we go again with that word again. Here we go again with that word again. He says, as thou hast given him power over all flesh, that he, talking about Jesus Christ, should give eternal life to as many as thou hast given him. Third verse, key verse. And this is life eternal. Here we go. Now we've been talking, he's been mentioning this eternal life. He's saying, look, you won't perish. Those that believe, you won't perish. You're going to have what? Eternal life. He's been mentioning this eternal life. And then here he is again saying, hey, I've given you power over all flesh. He said he's going to give them eternal life to as many as them that he has given him. And then he turns around and says, and this is life eternal. This is everlasting life. This is eternal life. What is the Holy Ghost? Now, y'all got to know this is in red now. So this is Jesus talking, but we know Jesus didn't say anything apart from the Father. So really, who is this talking to us? It's our Father. Come on now, y'all got to see it like this. We see red, we know that was Jesus, but he didn't say anything the Father didn't say. So really, anytime you read red, that's the Father talking directly to you. Look what the Father's saying. He said, look here, my children, my sons, my daughters there on the earth. He said, look, this is eternal life. This is life eternal. What is it, Father? That they, could that be the whosoever that we just read? Hallelujah. They, those whosoever that made the decision to believe, those whosoever who made the decision to sacrifice, those whosoever who made the decision to deny themselves, those whosoever, they, watch this, might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent. The Father is saying today that this is eternal life. This is life eternal. That they might know me. He said, I want them to get to know me. Know what? Know the only true God, which means that our Father knows there are other gods out there. But he just wants us to be assured that, look, out of all the other gods you hear about and all the other gods that get shows and movies, he said, I'm the only true living God. And Jesus Christ, whom I sent. And why did he send him? To manifest his love for the world. Do y'all see how this works? Because God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten Son. And whosoever shall believe will not perish, but have access to eternal life. And now we just read in John 17 that eternal life that the Father has given us was the ability for each and every believer to go in and get to know the Father. And the Son that he sent. which means eternal life starts now. See, we've been so busy for so long trying to get to heaven, and the Father's sitting up in there saying, no, I'm trying to get heaven in you. Y'all so busy trying to get up here with me, and I'm trying to get heaven in you so I can have heaven on earth. Ah, y'all. So then when you talk to people, you come across people, you hit, you reach out and you touch and you deal and you heal, and then you say what? The kingdom is before you. How? Because the kingdom is in me. He's in me here where? In the earth. This ain't in the sweet by and by. My opportunity, my access to walk in, to get to know him starts right now. And it's up to you how far you want to go. How deep you want to go with him is up to you. Come on now, saints. Knowing him starts now. I don't want to go my whole relationship preaching all these years and touching people and folks getting healed and delivered. And then I get up there and he say, get away from me. I work off of iniquity. He never took the time to know me. Then all that service, all that preaching, good preaching too. Folks that got saved under your voice. Healed under your voice. But you never took the time to get to know me one-on-one. I refuse to be in that boat. I will take the time to get to know who my Father is. And the reason I can do that is because of what Jesus Christ has done for me. He has opened up the door and given me access in to get to know who my Father is. Do y'all see how this works? And it's every believer has this access. You know, like I've said this before, folks be quick to try to meet some celebrity, don't we? And let them say you've been selected to go to the White House. Oh, you happy you get a chance to meet the president? Regardless of who the president is. Most of us talking trash and got all these issues with Trump, but if they told you you wanted to go see him, you'd be going, you'd be getting on the bus going. Yes, you would. Y'all be trying to get up there to get to that White House. Some folks didn't walk past it, but you getting that access in, you would go. Because really, in all honesty, hallelujah. Hallelujah. But y'all, folks will be trying to go. So if you can be that excited about meeting a celebrity, meeting the president, meet somebody who influenced, who was an influence to you. That's a statue, right? And here is the creator of all, saying, I've made a way for each and every person that believes on me now. This is only for believers. This ain't for folks that don't believe. You notice that Jesus never showed himself to nobody who didn't believe. This is the only people who believe can walk through the door. And he said, I made a way for you to come in and sit with me, commune with me, talk one-on-one with me by way of my son. Come on in. You would think more of us would be more willing to try to get in there and get to know him. The one who established the earth, who spoke nothing, something out of nothing, who created everything we see here. And we have access now by way of Jesus Christ to eternal life. And we just found out eternal life is knowing him. And oh, how he so much desires to get to know each and every one of us one-on-one, individually. He said, I want to just know you. Just come in and talk to me. Come in and share with me. Tell me what they did. Tell me what they said. And see, that's what I love about him. Because you're telling him something he know, but when you get to know him real, he'll talk to you like he don't even know. You'll be having communication, and he'll say something like, really? They said what? They said what they did to you now? And he knows everything. But because of the relationship that you're building with him, because y'all are communion, he said, I call you friend. You are friend. We're friends. He said, I'll talk to you, and it'll be as just like I don't even, he'll be talking to you, and you would think you don't know. And he does, he know everything. But he'll talk to you just like he don't, what they said. And that's why you go to him sometimes, try to ask him, now you see my wife over there, now you heard what she said, Nadine. I know he heard her. He heard her. He heard what she said, Nadine. Now that's something else right there. Now you gave it to me. You gave me that woman. Hallelujah. But you can just talk to him just like I'm talking to y'all right now. It's the same way you build your relationship. That's why I say sometimes so you're saying knowing him is here. Knowing him is on. What do I have to do? The best way to get to know him is just spending time with him. Cutting TV off, putting your phone down, cutting the radio off when you're in your car. You're going back and forth to work and just talk to him like he's sitting right in the passenger seat. Because guess what, y'all? He is. He's sitting right there. And he's so wanting to talk to you. He's so longing for you to have a converse with him. But sometimes we get so busy. And see, what the enemy will do is the enemy doesn't want you to do this. He doesn't want you to get to know him. He doesn't want you to get established in a relationship with him. He doesn't want you to be familiar with his voice.
Oh, God.
Because you got so many people who say what? I've never heard him. I tried to hear him. He don't ever talk to me. He's always talking. But see, what the enemy will do is get you so busy with other stuff. So he'll have your bills talking louder. He'll have your situation in your house talking louder. He'll have things on your job talking louder. And the whole time the Father's right there with you, talking with you, trying to guide you through every situation. And what you have to do is get to a place where you can learn how to quiet yourself, cut the music off, cut the TV off, take time, and just sit and listen. Not do so much talking. If you do talk, you ask a question, then take time and listen. Nobody converses with somebody and they just keep talking. You ever talk to somebody like that before? They telling you about a story and then they'll never let you. What you think about this? And then they get to talking the story, right? And then 5 minutes go by and then you'll get, okay, I see what I need to do. Oh, 10 minutes, they still talking. 20 minutes, they done told you, and you like, well, are you going to stop so I can, right? So it's the same thing with the Father. You talk, and then you be quiet to hear what he's going to say to you. That's how this works. That's the opportunities that we have on getting to know him. And the more we take time to get to know him, the more clear his voice becomes, the more we recognize that that's him. You recognize how he deals with you because he deals with everybody differently. He communes with everybody differently. Like I say earlier, I said, hold on, I don't use that word. See, that's how I know that's him. See, whenever I start getting words that I don't use, it's not that I don't know that word. I don't know the definition of it right away, but I don't use that in my everyday vocabulary. See, the Lord starts using words that I don't use in my everyday, and I'm like, oh, okay, that is God right there, because I don't use that word in my everyday vocabulary. But this is what he's saying. And then y'all look it up, and it's exactly what he's talking about. You see how that works? That's the Holy Ghost, right? But that's in communion. That's how he deals with me. He'll have a way he deal with you. He'll have a way he deal with you. That'll be totally different than the way he deal with me. But the way he deal with you is just as awesome, just as amazing. The way he deal with just as awesome. You see how it works? It doesn't make, just because he deals with us differently, it's just as awesome because he deals with you exactly where you are, according to where you are. And then how far you decided to go with him too, he'll deal with you. The farther you go, the clearer he gets. Right? Y'all see how this works? But it's all on taking the time to get to know him individually. And oh, how I long for every believer to take the time to get to know him themselves individually. Y'all see how this works? A couple more places and we're going to be done. Watch this. Watch this. Turn with me to 1 John. 1 John. Let me show you something in 1 John, and then we're going to go to Philippians, then we'll be done for the day. 1 John. And then we're going to flip to Philippians, and then we'll be done for the day. Watch this. All right. 1 John 4. First John 4, and we're going to start in the 7th verse. All right. Watch this. All right. 1 John 4, 7th verse, and look what it says here. It says, beloved, I like that. Let us love one another. That's good. That's good stuff right there. We can preach a sermon off that right there, huh? Well, you don't know what they did. Let us love one another. You don't know how they treat. Let us love one another. They lied on me. Let us love one another. Watch this. For love is of God. And everyone that loveth, watch this, is born of God and knoweth God. So the sign of me loving, the sign of me knowing him means I can love through any situation, no matter what happened, no matter how it went down, I can keep my cool, I can continue to be kind. You see how this works? I don't hold no grudges. I don't get puffed up. Why? Because what? I've taken the time to get to know him, and then me knowing him has given me the ability to love him and show love to people. He said, love is of God. And anyone that loveth is born of God, and not only born of God, but you know God. Watch this. A first. He or she that loveth not knoweth not God. He that loveth not does not show love. Leans to their own understanding. Has to have it their way. Goes about it the way that seems right to them. Right? Selfish. Because one thing about selfishness, selfishness is not going to have you, even if you show love, it'll be for a season, but eventually it's going to come back to being about you. That's one thing about selfishness, right? He said, look, a person that operates like that, a verse, he that loveth not knoweth not God. Now watch this. It didn't say you wasn't preaching. It didn't say you weren't in the music ministry. It didn't say you was an usher or a deacon. It said you don't know him. Which means, and that's scary for me, because that means you can preach for 20 years and not know him. You mean to tell me I can praise God and shout and speak in tongues and not know him? Oh, y'all got to get this one out. I can quote the scriptures from front to back, can tell you the scriptures, give it to you, tell you exactly where it comes from, tell you what, and not know him? Can do all of that apart from love? That's scary. See why it's so important on becoming love? He said, look, I've required you to become love, not talk it. Because we grew up talking love. And we know what 1 Corinthians 13 says. He said, but now I don't need you to know what it says. I need you to become it. See, that's the difference between knowing and knowing about it. See, we know about 1 Corinthians 13. Come on now, we know about it. But see, knowing it is becoming it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The more you know him, the more you become like him. Ah, Santa. See, and let me tell you something. The more you know him is going to bring about a change in you. Y'all see how this works? I don't want to go my whole life doing the things of God and not know him. Not operate in a place of love. Every believer should get to a place where they say, you know what? Let me just stop and make sure that we're on the same page. Mm-hmm. Let me not be so quick to move to make sure that we are like-minded, that I have the mind of Christ in me, that I'm on the right path. Because I don't want to get down the road 10 years, look back, and find out I walked 10 years knowing about you and never took the time to know him. Look at this. He said, that loveth not, knoweth not God. Why? For God is love. And anytime I do not walk in love, anytime I do not deal in love, operate in from a place of love, I'm acting and dealing off of the fact that I don't know. Even when it comes to correcting, I correct. I don't correct because I see a situation. I correct from a place of love. And even if I walk, and even if I understand and find out and know some things about a person, I don't address it right away. I make sure that when I address it, it comes from a place of love. Y'all see how this works? And even if I know a thing, if it's not coming from a place of love, keep your mouth closed. Because everything you do has to come from love. And if it's not, just don't say nothing. Just be quiet. What you think about it? Nothing. You see that? What you think about that? How you feel about that? Now you say, now what you think about? Nothing. Nothing at all. I'm not even going to address that. Because what? It's not from the right place. Y'all see how this works? Yes. But let me tell you something now. Let me tell you something. Because see, sometimes I say, well, how do we ever? No, you just keep walking with him. You keep taking time out to get to know him. And then watch this. Then you'll get to a place where everything you do is going to start coming from love. The reason you say, the reason you act, the reason you move is going to come from a place of love. And then you'll be able to deal and address some things right off the bat. Why? Because you already know your motive. You know the pureness of your heart. You know you're sincere. You're not, you don't have any hidden motives. Right? Love is just dealing. Love is just operating. Right? That's why I always say, if you ever got to say, nah, I'm coming to you in love, hush. Don't even say what you're about to say. Because love don't have to say that. Oh, God. Love just speaks. Because love knows it's coming from a place of love. Love, and see, as you start to walk with him and you start to train your heart in that, right? You start to train your heart that, hey, we're dealing from a place of love. We're not dealing off of motives. We're not dealing off of need. We don't have no hidden agendas. We're dealing from a place of love. Why? Because we're taking the time to get to know him. And then when you get to a place you start dealing, love is just going to always just speak. It's just going to deal. And sometimes you will offend people. Sometimes people will take it the wrong way. But it ain't even going to affect you because you know your heart. You know you're sincere. You know you don't mean no ill will toward that situation. But that comes all by way of knowing him. Y'all see how important knowing him is? Yeah. It is so key in knowing him. That's going to come through knowing him. That's why it's so important. Okay, watch this. So he said, look, God is love. So look, we were born of God, show love, says you know him. He said, but what? If you do not love, it don't mean you're a bad person. Just mean you don't know God. Y'all see how this works? Yeah. Come on now. All right. And look, when you think about that, we know a lot of saved folks who really don't know him, huh? Because we got a lot of saved folks that is mean and not walking in not an ounce of love. But preaching, evangelizing, traveling. And look what it says. They don't know me. He said, they don't know me. I don't care how long they've been preaching. I don't care how many churches they go to. They don't know me. Because when you know me, you show love. Y'all see how this works? All right, last place and we're done. Philippians. Philippians 3 and we're done. Last place and we're going to be done for today. Let me hit this real quick. Let me show you something about Paul. That's very intriguing. That deals along the same line that we're talking about right now. Philippians 3, and we're going to do starting in verse 7. I'm going to show you this real quick, and then we'll be done. We'll be done for today. Knowing him. To know him. To know him. To know him. All right. Philippians 3, verse 7. We there? Watch this. But what things were gained to me, those I counted loss for Christ. So everything that I was, that my stature. And when you understand, you look at the history of Paul. Paul wasn't no poor man. He was very, he had wealth. He was very intelligent. In his day, Saul's day, today he probably would have a wall full of plaques and degrees. He was schooled. He was very educated. He knew the law. Okay, so he was considered high stature, right? And he said everything that was gained to me through that life, he said, look, those I count loss. Look who he counted loss for Christ. He said, I'll release it all. I'll die to all of that, all of the accolades, all of the statue. Why? For Christ. Look at his heart now. Now, when you read this, now, as we read these few verses, look at the heart of Paul. This is Saul that is now Paul, right? Look at the heart. Look at his heart speaking. Now, watch this next one. Yea, doubtless, I count all things but loss. Now, look what he called it loss for. For the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus, my Lord. He said, I'll lose everything for the excellency in understanding or having knowledge of who? Of Christ Jesus. He said, I'll let it all go just to what? To know more about him. to have an excellent knowledge about who he is, how he operates, how he deals. I'll let go of the accolades. I'll let go of the stats. I'll let go of the monies that came. I'll let go of all of that for the knowledge of who he is. Watch this. For whom I have suffered the loss of all things. But watch this. He said, I've lost all things. But he said, look, I count them but dung. Watch this. That I may what? Win who? Christ. Do you see what his reward was? See, that's why I say the reward is always Christ. It's him. It's more of him. It's understanding him. It's knowing him more. That is the reward. He said, I'll let all that go that I may what? Win Christ. Look what his reward. And be found, ninth verse, in him. Not having mine own righteousness. Oh, hallelujah. We just talked about this a few Sundays ago. Which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ. The righteousness which is of God by faith. In other words, understanding his love for me. Right? Watch this. Last verse, 10th verse. That I may. Stop. Now look. He said that I may know him. Now this right here blows my mind every time I read this. Because here is Paul talking about that I may know him. And at this point in time, at the time of this writing, he had been walking with him now for about 20 years. Come on, saints. Here he is, been walking with him, been dealing, been operating, been ministering, been healing, been raising folks from the dead. And here he is 20 years down the road with Jesus Christ saying, I need to know him more. I need more. I need the excellency of the knowledge of who he is. I need more. I need to know him more. I need to go after him more. What? To know him more. And to know him is to become him more. Do you see how important it was to him to get to know him? How he said, look, I've lost it all for him. I lose it all. I kind of done anyway, that I've lost for him. Because I'm winning him. What is he winning? The knowledge of who he is. And here he is in the temple saying that I may know him. It was important to Paul that he knew him. Way above his financial status. Way above him having a big church. Oh, God, I got to get this. Way above what he drove or where he stayed. He said, none of that is important to me. He said, what's important to me is that I know him. I got to know him. I got to know him. He said, because look, if I get out there and get to dealing and operate, folks will be saved and I'll lose my life behind me. What? Because what? I didn't know him. So it was so important to Paul. So see, that when I read stuff like this, that catches my attention. Because if it was important to him, here this man been walking with him for 20 years. I'm not even near 20 years yet. And this man been walking with him for 20 years, and 20 years down the road, he's talking about, I need to know him. You would think he would know a little bit. You spent 20 years with somebody, you would think you would know him a little bit. But you got to understand who he's getting to know. Here he is 20 years down the road with the Father, saying what? I need to know him more. I need to know him more. He's steady going after knowing him. Which means to me that he spent the whole lifetime going after knowing him. Now watch this. In his lifetime of him going after knowing him and getting to know him, folks was healed. Oh God, y'all got to catch this. People were raised from the dead. Demons were cast out. But all of those things that he did in his life came through him going after knowing him. Oh, y'all got to get this. See, the service comes through you knowing him. And the more I desire to know him more, he's going to get the service. Folks going to be healed. Miracles are going to happen. Things are going to come together. Doors are going to open. Why? But I'm seeking after knowing him. So it should be way more important to the life of a believer now. A believer. Talking to all believers. It should be way more important to us. Way more than the miracles and the gifting and what my call is. Hallelujah. You want to know your call? This is your call as a believer. that you may know him and know him for yourself. And a pastor don't have to tell you how much God loves you. I know he loved me. A pastor ain't got to give you a word and say, you coming out of that? I know I'm coming out. The pastor ain't got to say, well, you know, things are going to turn around for you. It's already turned around. How? How you know that? Because I know him. Did y'all see how this works? It's so important in knowing him. Watch this. 10th verse, 11th verse, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable unto his death, not my death, his death. So through my knowing him, I'm going to understand the power that resurrected him. What resurrected him? The Holy Ghost. The fellowship of what he went through. And then not only the fellowship, how he viewed it, what he went through. Because Jesus went through a lot of stuff. Jesus experienced some hardships. But there's a perspective that he had when he went through things. When life come and situations came, there's a perspective that he had. He said, I'm going after knowing that. I want that. Y'all see what his goal is? See, he's looking at Jesus' life and he's saying, the way that you handled that situation, I want to handle my situations like you. The way that that didn't move you, I want that back there. It ain't about no material stuff. It's about when life comes and I don't see you moved, I want that. The only way I'm going to get to know, get that is by knowing you more. And the more I know you, the more I can understand how you were able to stand and not fall apart when everybody else that came before you fell apart. But here you are, you standing. The Israelites walked around the mountain for 40 years. He went in for 40 nights. They died in the mountain. He came out in power. What did he do? I need to know what happened there. What was his perspective? I need to know what. Because, see, I see a different result from Jesus than what happened to them boys down there. He came out with power. They died. I need to know what went on here. How do I do that? Father, I need to know you more. I'm diligently seeking after him. I'm seeking. How did you stand there when they came, when they went to stone you? How did you not move when they came and tried to set you up? They was always trying to set them up. They was always trying to get them to do stuff on the Sabbath. They was always saying blasphemy because him and the Father was one. They didn't understand that him and the Father was one by way of the Spirit. They thought he was trying to. That's why he said, don't count it robbery. He said, count it robbery not to be equal to the Father. Don't count it robbery to be equal to me. We are one together now. How do you get these things? I know you. I'm going after you. As I know you, I'm going to understand. Oh, you got up. You got up. You rose. You fellowship of your suffering. You went through some stuff, but you stood. You didn't let sin against you produce sin in you. I need to know how you did that. How do you not let sin produce in you? What was your mindset? What were you looking at? What were you focused on? I need to know that. All of this comes by way of knowing him. That's how this works. And then when I know him, he says, "What?" And then I'm going to be made conformed unto his death. I want to understand that it was him that did it. And because he did it, I have access to everything now. Because he did it. Where does that come from? By knowing him. Does that make sense to you? So see, saints, it's so important to take the time out, get in his word, and know him. To know him is so much more important than anything else in this life. I want to know him, saints. I don't want to get down the road and say, I knew about him. Because you can do a lot now. You can do a lot knowing about him. Knowing about him will puff you up, too. Give your head knowledge. It puffs you up. He said knowledge puffeth you up. Knowing about him. But when I know him, I can operate in love, and no matter what happens, I can still deal. Y'all see how this works? Knowing him. Amen. So that's the word for the day. That's our sermon for the day. Amen. I thank God for all the hearers and the doers. I hope that this word pricked some hearts. Because I know when I started back studying, it pricked mine. Come on now, I'm be honest with you. I said, hold on. As I started studying this again, I said, hold on. Let me make sure. I don't want to be knowing about you, doing this stuff through knowing about you. No, I need to make sure I know you without a shadow of a doubt. Y'all see how this works? Amen. So that's why I say I hope a word like this pricks your heart and just help you internalize and see to make sure that, hey, let me check myself. That's all the word. See, the word makes you accountable. It makes you accountable. So anytime you hear a word like this, you just make you look at yourself and say, oh, let me make sure that I'm doing this the right way. That I'm not just, you know, because coming to church every Sunday can be like you think you know him. You come to church every Sunday. Just as mean. You pay your tithes every month, every two, or however you do it. And just as don't have the nastiest attitude, but paying your tithes, coming to church. And you'll let that take the place of knowing him. When that's just knowing about him. You won't know him. You see how this works? So it's so important that we get to know him. And I beseech all my brothers and sisters in the Lord that you take the time to what? Get to know him. So we'll be talking about this the next few Sundays. Amen. I hope by the time we finish this, I hope that it changes the trajectory on some people's lives. That it's not about everything else that you've probably been sold or taught by. It's really about just simply getting to know him. In Jesus' name. Amen. Let me give you the scriptures real quick and then I'm going to let you go. Amen. The scriptures for Wednesday night is going to be going to start off with Psalms 138 and 2. Psalms 138, verse 2. We're going to do Luke 9 and 23. Luke 9, verse 23. We're going to do John 12, verse 24. John 12, verse 24. We're also going to do Acts 16, verse 25. Acts 16, verse 25. Next, we're going to do Romans 12 and 21. Romans 12 and 21. Next, we're going to do Philippians 2 and 21. Philippians 2 and 21. And last, we're going to do 2 Timothy 1 and 7. 2 Timothy 1, verse 7. Real quick, Psalms 138 and 2, Luke 9 and 23. John 12 and 24, Acts 16 and 25, Romans 12 and 21, Philippians 2 and 21, 2 Timothy 1 and 7 will be the scriptures for the week. And we will see you all on Wednesday at 7 o'clock Bible study for those who decide to join us. In Jesus' name, be blessed.